thousands turn out to say a final goodbye to the Potter's favourite son, Sir Stanley Matthews, paying their final respects some of footballers' most famous names.
You can't explain to young people today just how good he was. You know, he was absolutely superb.
Hello, good evening. On the day Stoke-on-Trent said goodbye to one of its most famous sons, and the world of football said thank you to one of its greatest ambassadors. 100,000 people stood in the rain as Sir Stanley Matthews' coffin made its way through the streets of the Potteries. As the hearse was driven into the Britannia Stadium, home of Stoke City, the club he served so loyally, the crowd broke into applause. From there, the cortege made its way through the streets of the city, past his house and the statue erected to him only a few years ago. And then it was driven to St. Peter's Church, where more crowds were gathered to pay their respects. Well, Bob Hall's been in Stoke all day and was at the church service. Bob.
Bob, it has been a quite remarkable day in every way, shape and form, but you wouldn't expect it to be any other way, would you? You can't be as high-profile a man as he was and have a private funeral. It's been very much a people's day. I'm in the foyer at the football ground, the flowers are outside, the messages are stuck to the wall and the replica shirts are there, and they're still coming in to sign the book of condolence. But I tell you something, he wouldn't have wanted it any other way. He was that sort of man. And the fact is that the people came out today, and, you know, I don't think you needed to be a football fan to have sensed the loss and the sense of mourning in the city of Stoke today. For the fans who waited on a chill March morning, the last chance for them to pay their respects to soccer's first knight, the man who in four decades put himself and Stoke City firmly on the map. They waited in some cases for hours with their floral tributes, some with a single flower, others with elaborate bouquets. They stood and stared with their thoughts, many and varied, all for one very special man. And as the funeral procession left to wind its way around the streets to the church, Sir Stan's contemporaries, each a hero in his own right, remembered.
A very sad occasion, but by the same token, I think, you know, we've got to celebrate what a wonderful career he had, because there's not many people can say when they've finished and they're going on the way down that they've had a wonderful career like he's had.
You can't explain to young people today just how good he was. You know, he was absolutely superb and very difficult to dispossess. If you were a fullback, it was a nightmare. You know, you're going on the field thinking, you know, I don't know how I'm going to handle this, but I better get on with it. It was such a great player.
He was known the world over, like Pelle is known the world over. Stanley Matthews was that type of player, and he just epitomised everything about the sport, and you couldn't get any higher than this man climbed.
Sir Stan was a frequent visitor to his old school, St Luke's. Today's youngsters stood and remembered. They'll miss the white-haired old man who brought such a smile to their grandfather's eyes. A statue of Sir Stan highlights his birthplace. It became a focal point for many in Hanley, for whom young Stan will forever remain just that. From teenager to his early 50s, the Victoria Ground was packed. Many only went to see Stanley on the right wing. The flowers, another tangible tribute to those memories. And so to St Peter's Church, the cameras clicked, necks craned. In and among the famous faces were fans with tribute scarves. Some just wanted to be there. To a man they had a story to tell. Now was that time. Time to bid Sir Stan farewell.
Well, around 1,000 people were in St Peter's Church for the funeral service. Tens of thousands more heard it on loudspeakers outside the church and at the statue of Sir Stan in Hanley. Joanne Rittle reports.
Sir Stan's family and famous faces inside the church, crowds outside and at the statue of Sir Stan in Hanley were united in their celebration of his life. The Stoke City director, Peter Coates, was the first to stand up in church.
He enjoyed a place in the community that money can't buy. And that's why today, notwithstanding his long and successful life, there will be lumps in the throat and tears in the eyes of many as they make their last sad farewell.
Jimmy Armfield played alongside Sir Stan for England and Blackpool.
A true great who had the temperament, skill, artistry, speed, balance, and above all, humility.
Good evening. Welcome to a special live edition of 30 Minutes to mark the life of Sir Stanley Matthews. I'm at the home of Stoke City Football Club, where I'm joined by two other giants of the game, Brian Clough and Ron Atkinson.
And I'm at the Matthews statue in the heart of the city, where I'll be meeting footballers who played with him and supporters who idolised him.
Today, the city of Stoke and the world of football went into mourning following the death of Sir Stanley Matthews. In this job, we talk a lot about sporting greats, but the words hardly seem adequate enough when it comes to Sir Stanley. Brian Clough, just how great a player was Sir Stanley Matthews?
Difficult to tell you very quickly, because I'm in a somber mood, and yet every time I either saw him play or had the privilege of meeting him, he made me happy and he made me smile. So I'm having to switch from that mood, he gave me so much pleasure, to a somber mood that we've lost him. But I don't think there was anybody better, and I don't think there will be.
And what did he do for the image of the game? Because the image of the game has taken a bit of battering in recent years, Ron Atkinson.
Yeah, well, he's from another breed. He conducted himself brilliantly. Never an ounce of trouble with him. And what he did, he was a complete professional. He would be, I would guess, he's probably the best player I've ever seen, I think.
And the best player you've ever seen?
I would think so. I think if you take, you have to draw a line with George Best, Tom Finney and Stanley Matthews and take your pick. I'd probably go for Matthews.
And you would put him at the very best as well, Brian?
I would, actually. I spent a spell in the game playing, and I didn't want a stocking. I didn't want Father Christmas to come every year more than I wanted to play with Stanley Matthews.
So we can say with certainty there will never be another Sir Stanley Matthews. They broke the mould when he was born here in the Potteries, Fraser Shepherd reports.
89 Seymour Road, Hanley. Birthplace of the world star who started by sweeping the floors and cleaning the boots at Stoke City. His debut came at the age of 17.
I received a £10 sign-on fee, which I thought in those days was a fortune. I started off with £5 a week in the winter playing and £3 a week in the summer.
Matthews helped his club win the second division title, and his international career was taking off. A hat-trick against Czechoslovakia and some great moments against the oldest rivals among his 54 caps.
Scotland, dark shirts, were up against a really first-class combination when they met England at Manchester, and the result was the greatest international defeat they've ever suffered. From England's point of view, it almost cancelled out Bannockburn. Finally, there was a goal by Matthews, whose dazzling play throughout made him the hero of the match. England's right-winger, star of many internationals, had nevertheless not scored a goal for England for 5 years. By getting England's eighth, he clinched a record victory and rounded off a great personal triumph.
The clans gathered in full force and full regalia to watch the international against England. English prestige is personified by Stanley Matthews, who didn't give tuppence for a Scottish forward line. What a man! Stanley's magic gave the opening for Lofthouse, who scored the next. 4-1 at half-time. A beautiful centre from Matthews was headed in by Wilshaw for number 5. Finally, Matthews and Revy joined forces to give the Wolverhampton player his fourth goal of the match, a Wembley record.
In 1947, a shock for the Potteries. A fee of £11,500 took Matthews to Blackpool. But life by the seaside wasn't always happy.
The great little wizard has it again. A flick to centre finds Perry, who crashes it home into the Bolton net.
There were FA Cup final defeats in 1948 and 1951, but Blackpool were back there in 1953 for one of the most famous finals of them all, which will always be known as the Matthews final.
Presented the cup to Johnston at Blackpool's third attempt. And there was a cup winner's medal at last for the great Stanley Matthews. For the only time in the history of the FA Cup, the winning team gave the chair of honour to two men, their captain and the man who had become a football legend.
In 1961, Matthews came home to the Victoria Ground, the fee just £2,500.
We could not have achieved so much so soon had we not signed Stanley Matthews. He was our shortcut back to getting on our feet again. On the field, particularly, Stan made us a far better side. He's still a very great player. And of course, initially, he brought the crowds back to Stoke.
36,000, four times the average number this season, were there for the sheer joy of watching the ace player of this generation.
Around the world, Matthews became an ambassador for British football. He tried his hand at management, but it was his profile as a player that saw him welcomed wherever he went. He was the first footballer to be knighted. Back in the Potteries, there was an honorary degree from Keele University. And in the shopping centre of Hanley, a statue that today has become a focal point for those remembering him. At 80, another tribute that brought many of his contemporaries to Stoke-on-Trent to celebrate once again.
Well, I think I'm in a dreamland, because the telegrams and the cards I had from fans, it's unbelievable. I simply don't understand, because I'm a footballer, I've seen the world free, and I enjoyed it. I haven't a surgeon who saved lives, and a footballer who've enjoyed life.
When Stoke City left the Victoria Ground for the Britannia Stadium, Matthews was as proud as ever to maintain his association with the club. He was president and a regular spectator until his death last night. The nation paid its first tribute with a minute's silence before last night's friendly at Wembley between England and Argentina.
Football, you know, and certainly if you're over 50 and you remember the era when Stanley Matthews was the biggest star in world football, then yeah, you'd appreciate how sad people like me are today. But he was such a star in world football that people travelled hundreds of miles when 100 miles was a long way. And in world terms, just a wonderful, wonderful person to show around the world. He was just magic.
He was brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And Walter Winterbottom, the England team manager, more or less said sometimes to me, just give the ball to Matthews now and get round the spot and he'll get it over. We'll ace away so it won't hurt. And I used to think, crikey. And that's the first time I played with Matthews in the England team. Brilliant.
I stood in this tunnel with him for the 100,000 visitor behind a cardboard cutout, and it was one of the greatest days of my life to meet him. I mean, he was fitter then than I was, and I was still captain of England. But I said, let's put a performance in that he would have been proud of. And although we haven't won here tonight, I think he'd be looking down from somewhere and saying, yeah, those guys really had a crack at it, and they gave the nation a little bit of hope, and that's what I wanted.
He was a model professional, and it's a shame there can't be a few more around today like him, but as I said, he was different class, and he was different class when I spoke to him and met him. And everyone will have very, very good memories of him.
After all this, were there any regrets?
Yeah, the only thing I regretted, I finished when I was 50. I could have gone on 2 years, but I thought 50 was a good year like to finish. But I could have gone on another 2 years. That was a terrible mistake. I always regret that. I knew I could do it because I knew my body, I knew what I could do, and I still had my little bit of quickness, and I was pretty fit.
It's an incredible statement, Ron Atkinson.
Was it only in that time he could have played at 50? I mean, he couldn't have played in the modern game at 50 now.
I don't know about at 50, but he certainly could have done when he was 40. I mean, he
really
was,
at 40?
Oh, he was a fitness fanatic. He was quick. He got good control. He would have been as great in any era as he was in that era. He was just, he was a player. I never ever saw him play anything less than outstanding. And it's one of those when you, like our era, your father would say, you've got to go and see him today. It'll be the last, you won't see him again. And like 10 years later, he'd be saying the same thing. You'd be coming to Villa Park or Anfield or wherever you're going to watch a match.
I'm going to say a terrible thing, Ron, but I actually went through a spell where I liked him better than my dad. And that's a terrible thing to say.
Yeah, yeah.
But we all went through that spell. It's as simple as that. And he made me smile himself. And it isn't a thing to smile, but he won't mind us smiling. But when he said he could have gone on from 50, possibly till 52, we were thinking about retiring and our pensions getting. We were looking forward to that, Stanley, instead of you were looking forward to two more years, you villain. You were responsible for half the people in this country being unemployed because you wouldn't retire.
How does he compare then with the modern players?
Well, apparently, I mean, this is only from hearsay, apparently before the war, he was supposed to be quite a goal scorer. And then I think, from what I've read, that he made up his mind his job was to provide things. And his classic trick was to go to the fullback, drop his shoulder, take it, hit the dead ball line, and cut it back to the likes of Nat Loftus, people that could score goals. He would have scored 200 off him in a season.
Thank you.
You scored 250 overall. Do you think if you had a winger like Sir Stanley Matthews, you'd have doubled that figure?
I'm not sure about doubled it, but I would have occasionally indulged in a wee bit of cheating and I'd have gone out with a blindfold on and just got me position where I knew eventually the ball was going to come, because you could stand still and put him in when he crossed him. He used to do all the work, just say, stand still. David Mackay had this off as well. Stand there, I'll put it to your feet. Stanley did that. You saw it on clip. He just went, bump. And Nat Loftus was just stroking him in, you know. Ah, what a job Nat Loftus had.
How does he compare, Brian, with George Best and David Beckham?
Difficult always comparisons, but I saw more of George Best than young Beckham. But I'm afraid that they will have to accept that they couldn't lace his boots. It's an old phrase, but it's a true phrase. It's like saying a modern-day painter now, and I'm not up in the world of art, but is he as good as Renoir? The answer is no, he's not. He was the best. Stanley was the best. And no matter what you say, you cannot put words to describe what he was like. He put a smile on everybody's face. And you know when I'm going to bed tonight? I'm going a happy man. You know why? I'm going to dream about him.
Lovely. We're going to take a short break. When we get back, more from Brian and Ron, and we'll be meeting a footballer who played alongside Sir Stanley Matthews, and we'll be talking to the fan who got free bed and breakfast in Germany just by mentioning his name. Join us again in a couple of minutes. Welcome back to this special live edition of 30 Minutes to pay tribute to Sir Stanley Matthews. I'm at the Britannia Stadium with Brian Clough and Ron Atkinson, and we'll be hearing more from them in a moment. But first, we're joining Phil Mepham at the Matthews statue in Stoke City Centre.
Well, the first person we are going to speak to here is Dennis Herod, who played for Stoke City between 1941 and 55. Dennis, you nearly won the title with Sir Stan in 47, didn't you?
Very, very close, yes. Indeed, we did, yes.
But
tragedy happened. There was a rift between the management, Stan and Neil Franklin, because he was jealous of their ability and the publicity they got. So in his wisdom, before we played the last match of the season, which the season was extended at the time because of bad weather, no floodlights, etc., he sold Stan to Blackpool. Now fancy a manager selling the best footballer in the world, the best forward in the world, to Blackpool, and we got beat 2-1.
Now, if Stan had been in this side, would he have won the title for you?
Yeah, we'd have won 5-2, if I hadn't let any more in.
Well, let's move across now to Terry Connery. Terry, you played between 67 and 79. You were the man who wore the number 7 shirt for Stoke City, don't you?
I was, Phil. That was thrust upon me after Stan left in 65, and there was a few incumbents in the meantime. But when I came to play obviously on a regular basis. I didn't realise the importance of the seven till maybe 12 months down the line, when, as I said, I was the regular possessor of the seven jersey. And Stan used to joke to me about it, that he used to obviously remind me from time to time to make sure that I looked after that, because it was a special number.
So did he ever sort of ever push you in the right way and give you a few tips on, you know, number seven, it's an important one?
Well, he just said, you've got all the shapes that I had. Maybe I was, but I think he was being kind to me, Phil, because nobody could replace him. Nobody could fill the shoes that, obviously, when he played, he was supreme.
Were you aware that people were perhaps expecting you to replace him with that number seven shirt?
I wasn't aware of it, Phil, no, until maybe comparison was made. Maybe I joined in 67, so I became a regular in 69, and 70, 71, when we had a very, very good spell within the league, we got to cups and that. And then it became obvious that people were saying, well, we've got somebody that's going to play that number seven for years, just like Stan did.
OK, final word from you, Dennis. You must have been in absolute awe of him, because you were a youngster with him, weren't you?
Yes, I was. He was. People talk about his football ability, but I'd rather talk about him as a man. I find him a tremendous person. I joined the Stoke Club in about 1944, and the dressing room was full of stars. And Stan and Freddie and Neil Franklin and Frankie Sue, they looked after me as if I was one of their own sons. He was a lovely person, and I think so much of him. I could, if you have more time, I'd tell you some more kind stories about him.
We'd love to, Dennis, but unfortunately we're running out of time. But thank you, gentlemen, for joining us. With that, for now, back to Gary at Britannia Park.
Yes, Phil, there with two well-known players in their time paying great tributes. A modest man, Sir Stanley Matthews, on modest money, Ron Atkinson.
Yeah, at the time, I mean, players obviously didn't get paid what they were worth. I mean, Stanley, I've seen it quoted, and he said it at the start of the programme, where he didn't earn a lot of money, but he never thought about that. He just felt privileged to have been a professional player, and he'd seen the world, as he said, for nothing. So he, in his way, had as much enjoyment out of what he did as maybe, you know, today's megastars.
Why do you think, Brian Clough, that era was so modest? All those men, I mean, dear Billy Wright was so modest. All those players,
you
modest,
know,
polite.
Four times you used that word, you know. That's four heart attacks for me. I didn't know there was a name modest in the English dictionary.
They would have set you good examples.
Good. He was absolutely brilliant. Why was he so modest? I think
why was that era so modest? Because he represented all that era.
Working class era, different world.
Yeah, and why was he so modest then?
Him
same
personally.
Reason?
No, he knew you can afford to be certain things when you know you're good. He knew he was good. He didn't go around shouting about it like some of us did, but he knew he was good, and that brings out the modesty in somebody. When you put a pair of football boots on and a ball, and you see a poor opponent there and say, well, poor lad, you're going to have a rotten 90 minutes, you don't have to say it, you just got to prove it, and that's his modesty in itself. And that's why everybody liked him. He didn't crow.
And what will he best be remembered?
You've got that problem, actually. But I know you're trying and learning, but he's laughing.
I couldn't play football like him, and I'm certainly not as modest or great a man as he is. But Ron Atkinson, what will he best be remembered for? Which game? The Matthews final? Or?
Yeah, I think that probably will stand out, because it was the year that so many things happened. I mean, it was the coronation year. Gordon Richards wins his first derby. They climb Everest. But everybody wanted Matthews. They'd been to two Wembley finals just beforehand, and he'd failed. Everybody in the country wanted Matthews to win it. And the thing I remember, it was the first football match I ever saw on telly. One of the lads at the street had a telly, and we all piled in to watch it, you know, and the way it happened, you couldn't have written it, could you? 3-1, and then they pull it back and win 4-3. And that would be... There was a lot of games, but that would be the game we'd be remembered.
When we see these matches on television, Brian, I mean, television wasn't sophisticated like it is now, and it seems slower and everything else, but actually, the football was really good and fast, wasn't it? I mean, you played in it, but the television pictures don't do justice to the players
don't.
Or the matches.
The television's developed, obviously, and it's only right to say possibly football's quickened up as well. Yeah. But I've seen a clip on your programme tonight, and the ball's played to Stanley Matthews. He's stationary, and it actually makes the ball stationary.
Yes.
Now, if you want to run a competition the next time anybody saw a ball and a player stationary in modern-day football, but he actually did it. He was stationary, he put his foot there. So it is different. It is a bit quicker now, but it's no point in just making the ball stationary and yourself stationary. You've got to do something with it then. And he was a genius at doing it. There's no point in having a microphone if you can't sing like Sinatra. You know, you've had the problems all your life, having a microphone, and you were hopeless at what you do. Only kidding. Go on.
Sorry, I was going to say, I mean...
I played for a manager, Arthur Turner, that played with him, you know, before the war. He told a lovely story about him. He said they were playing at Blackpool in a cup match. He said, I don't know whether they had a player sent off, another one injured, no substitutes, down to 9 men, half-time, winning 1-0. And the manager said, look, when you come in, Stanley will play up the field on his own. You just give him the ball and everybody defend and give him the ball. And Arthur Turner was a hard taskmaster that said he went out for 45 minutes, he kept the ball. They won 1-0, he kept the ball for 45 minutes.
OK, more a little later, because now we're going back to Phil Meppham. He's at the Matthews statue, where he's now joined by some of Stan's greatest fans and friends. Phil.
Yes, that's right. They didn't actually play with Sir Stan, but they are some of his greatest admirers. Sid Cartledge, I'll start with you. Now, you're the man who actually got bed and breakfast and lodgings on the back of Sir Stan, didn't you?
That's right, Phil. It was in 1962-63 season. We went to Vienna to watch Stoke City play in a friendly match. There were 70,000 there, and we were on our way back, and we actually got lost in the Black Forest. And it was late at night, we'd got nowhere to stay. We were trying to find somewhere, couldn't get any accommodation. And we came across this little bar, and we went in, we were having a quiet drink, and couldn't speak the language. And somebody said, Stanley Matthews. One of my friends said, Stanley Matthews. And the man behind the bar said, Stanley Matthews, Stoke City. And we said, yes. He said, we need to stay the night, sleep, you see. So he found us accommodation. It didn't cost anything. We had a magnificent breakfast in the morning, and they waved us off as if we'd been there for 6 months.
All on the back of
Stanley Matthews. Great man.
Doug, let's move around to you. You were physio.
Yeah.
And at one point you had a great idea to get a bit more fitness into the man, didn't you?
Well, I introduced weight training at Stoke those days. And the first morning he reported for training, I said, Stan, welcome. I've introduced weight training here, lightweight, you know. So he looked at me.
And he walked away. So he didn't fancy that.
He had his own unique way of training.
And he was a fit man, though?
Very, very fit.
Let me move across, if I may, to Martin. Now, Martin, you're the editor of a Stoke City fanzine. Not always popular amongst footballers, but with Sir Stan.
Yes, we were amazed a few years ago to receive a note from him shortly after a big local derby match. He had picked up a copy, and he took the time and trouble, which astounded us, but it was just so like Sir Stan. To send us a note saying how much he'd enjoyed the fanzine and to keep up the good work.
And that must have meant a lot.
It meant everything to us. You know, when you know you do a fanzine and you do it for the fans, and maybe I shouldn't be that surprised then, because Stan was a fan and he was a man, he was a Stoke-on-Trent man, you know, and this area meant everything to him, and the same was true, you know, he meant everything to us.
OK, gentlemen, thank you very much indeed. Thank you for braving the rain. Back to Gary at the Britannia Stadium.
And a final word from Ron Atkinson. Will he always be remembered in football?
Always be remembered as an all-time great, probably the greatest.
Thank you. Well, that's all we've got time for now. My thanks to Brian and Ron and everyone at the Matthews statue on a sad night, but in the memory of Sir Stanley Matthews. From us, goodbye.